Hola amigos. Hi, welcome to our event. I'm Anselmo Rodriguez Manso. I'm honored to be the chair of Blue Cross Blue Shield of Louisiana's Hispanic American Employee Resource Group. I will be your host today. Today we get together to celebrate the 4th of July of 1776, the day of independence of our United States of America. During a time that our nation was struggling to find its place in the concert of nations, in the world, our people and our Continental Army was in direct armed conflict against one of the most powerful empires of the world at the time, the British Empire. It took the help of equally powerful friends in terms of supplies, arms, and people to allow our young nation to stand against such a formidable adversary. Because of our formal education, many of us understand the contribution of France and her honorable Marshal of Lafayette to such cause. Sadly, the same education system does not educate us on the enormous contribution of the Spanish crown and Hispanics to the cause of freedom of the 13 colonies, as we were known then. I am honored to introduce Mr. Chad Leblanc, who is an author, president of the Isleños Heritage and Cultural Society of Louisiana, and a member of our Hispanic American Employee Resource Group, to help us understand the magnitude and relevance of the Hispanic contribution to the independence of the United States of America. Without further delay, Chad Leblanc.
Hey, thank you, Anselmo. And I wanna thank Anselmo and the Hispanic ERG for the opportunity to present this to you today. I think this is an important part of Louisiana history and one that is often overlooked. So as Anselmo said, I am the president of the Canary Islanders Heritage Society of Louisiana. Our society was formed about 25 years ago, and our mission is to preserve and promote the history and heritage of our ancestors who came here from the Canary Islands. And that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about those people, why they came here, and how they played a role in American independence. I like to start by talking about the islands themselves. A lot of people aren't too familiar with the Canary Islands. The Canary Islands are located off the northwest coast of Africa, specifically off the coast of Morocco. They've been under the Spanish crown since 1479, so quite a long time. The islands are actually constitute two provinces of Spain. The two main islands you see there in the middle, Tenerife and Gran Canaria, is where 85% of the population lives. And you maybe see this faint diagonal line that delineates the two provinces that make up those two provinces of Spain. This is an illustration of the currents in the Atlantic Ocean. And the significance of this is it indicates how important the Canary Islands were. Basically, if you were going to sail from Europe to the New World, you were going to sail through the Canary Islands. That's where the current carried you. So effectively, the Canary Islands would be your last stop before you hit the open waters of the Atlantic. So it became a place where you would get supplies, you would get extra crew if you needed, make any repairs to your boat. So they were very important in terms of travel to the New World. This man who you should recognize, Christopher Columbus, he actually sailed through the islands on all of his voyages. This map shows you his fourth voyage. You can see there the line goes straight through the Canary Islands. And actually on his second voyage here, he stopped at the island of La Gomera and was given clippings of sugarcane that he brought over to the New World. And that's how sugarcane ended up on this side of the ocean. Columbus had a house in the islands on the island of Gran Canaria, and there's the house pictured. It still stands today, and it serves today as a museum in the islands, so you can still visit it today. So the question now would probably be, what connection would Louisiana have with the Canary Islands so far away, and why would people come from there to here? So in order to explain that, we need to go through some Louisiana history. So this is North America in 1750. As you can see on the East Coast, you have the British colonies. The Spanish in orange there have Mexico and Florida. And then in purple, there's the French territory, which is basically all the lands surrounding all the waterways that drain into the Mississippi River. As you can imagine, there were often skirmishes between both sides in these border areas. In fact, one of those skirmishes was the genesis that sparked the French and Indian War, which plays a very important part in this story. At the time, a very young colonel, this man, George Washington, only at the age of 22, was dispatched to the Pittsburgh area to discuss with the French the building of a fort there. He was accompanied by some Native American guides, and en route, they encountered a French scouting party. Part of that scouting party was a man named Jumonville, who was an important French diplomat. There's varying accounts of what exactly took place, but the end result was that Jumonville and his men were killed. And the French saw this as an unprovoked attack and basically as murder. And that was really the spark that lit everything up to start the French and Indian War. Another interesting side effect of that war is, as you can see here, this shows you the various theaters of that war. It was stretched all the way up to Nova Scotia. And Nova Scotia had been British since 1710, and the Acadians had been allowed to stay there, but now that war has broken out, that's one of the reasons why they decided They decided to make all the Acadians leave. So just before the war is coming to an end in 1762, France realizes that it's going to lose all of its territory in North America. And rather than allow Britain to take over all of what was Louisiana, they decide to cede part of it to Spain. They also do that to compensate Spain for their loss of Florida to the British. So when the war ends in 1763, the Treaty of Paris is signed, and this map shows you how the land is now divided. You see here in red is the original British territory. The pink is what the British have now gained as a result of the war. The Spanish now have this territory in yellow, and they already have the territory in orange. And you can see that basically the Spanish territory consists of all the land west of the Mississippi River, including what they call the Isle of Orleans, which is basically the city of New Orleans and the surrounding area and the land south of the Amite River. This map, which is an illustration of Louisiana as it looks today, shows you in a little bit more detail where that delineation was. Basically, it's the equivalent today if you go from Ascension Parish into East Baton Rouge Parish, you would be going from Spanish to British territory. So the Spanish were slow to build a presence in Louisiana. They took over the territory in 1763, but the first Spanish governor, Antonio de Ulloa, didn't arrive until 1766. The French Creole colonists in New Orleans did not welcome him, and they refused Spanish rule. There was an uprising against Ulloa and his men, and that led to what was called the Louisiana Rebellion of 1768. And as a result of that rebellion, Ulloa and his wife, who was pregnant at the time, fled the area and didn't even get a chance to raise a Spanish flag in New Orleans. When word of this got out, the Spanish sent another man to take over. The second Spanish governor, which I didn't list here, was actually the previous French governor who served in the interim until this man arrived. This is the third Spanish governor of Louisiana, Alejandro O'Reilly. O'Reilly was an Irishman who served in the Spanish militia and was a decorated war hero. He stopped in Cuba en route to New Orleans and picked up 3,000 men. And he took formal possession of New Orleans, raised the flag, and then immediately started an investigation on the men who had conducted the rebellion. He convicted those responsible, and the ringleaders of it were publicly executed in the streets of New Orleans. That established Spanish rule in Louisiana. O'Reilly wasn't governor very long, just a few months, but a man he brought with him, Luis Unzaga, served as the fourth governor when O'Reilly left. Unzaga assisted the American rebels by privately delivering supplies up the Mississippi River under the protection of the flag of Spain. He delivered 5 tons of gunpowder via that route, which was vital to the Americans at closer to the beginning of their beginning of the war there. Another thing that Gonzaga did is he drafted a letter to George Washington in early 1776. And in that letter, he referred to Washington as General de los Estados Unidos Americanos, which translates to General of the United States of America. And this was the first time that Washington had heard that term. He liked it so much that he continued to use it. And from that moment on, they no longer referred to their territory as the 13 colonies. It was referred to as the United States of America. Of course, in July of that year, the Declaration of Independence is signed, which makes which establishes the United States as a separate entity from Britain. The fifth governor, Bernardo de Galvez, comes in on January 1st, 1777. Now, Galvez was a very well-known man back in Spain, very accomplished. His family was also very, very noted for a lot of things they did. He was born in Malaga, Spain, as you can see there. And actually, he brought some colonists later on from Malaga to Louisiana to establish a new community. And that community was New Iberia. Now, Galvez was given instructions to sell supplies to the Americans and to assist them covertly, not to do it, you know, in secret so that they wouldn't be aware. This is kind of a timeline of events after Galvez arrives. You can see there in January, he's named governor. February, he's instructed to sell those supplies. And one of the things Galvez also realizes when he arrives is that there's really very few men in the militia, and they really don't have a force to defend the area if the British were to decide to attack. So on August 15th, 1777, Galvez, through the Crown of Spain, orders the recruitment and enlistment of men to serve in the militia from the Canary Islands. His father, Matias de Galvez, was commandant of the Canary Islands at that time. This is actual text from the recruitment order. As you can see, they had specific things they were looking for in these recruits. They wanted them to be within a certain age range and a certain height. They also didn't want anybody with a criminal history or any kind of bad things in their past. And they were basically paid a sign-on fee, like a sign-on bonus. They were paid half of that money when they signed up, and they got the other half when they got to New Orleans. And they also received a small amount of money every day while they waited to leave, I guess as an incentive to not change their minds. They also had recruiters that were sent out to find recruits. And as you can see, the taller the person they could find, the greater the payment. And these heights seem very short, but I was told that the measuring system for this at that time was a little different than it is today. Another thing is they wanted bachelors, but they quickly realized that they were not going to find 700 bachelors in the islands. So they allowed married men to come and to bring their families along with them. This resulted in almost 2,300 people coming to Louisiana from the islands. So here the timeline continues. You can see the recruitment was in August of 77. Roughly a year later, in July of 78, the first ship set out from the Canary Islands to Louisiana. That ship arrived on November 1st. It had to stop in Havana because there were some sick people on board the ship that needed medical care. The ship actually arrived with two more people than it left with. There were three babies born on the ship and one person died. This is a list of the first wave of ships that came from the islands. You can see there the day that they departed and how many passengers they had on board. The first two ships actually arrived in New Orleans around the same time, even though they left at different times. And that's because that first ship stopped in Havana, as I just said, whereas the La Victoria, the second ship, came directly to New Orleans. So in the year that the recruits were being found in the Canary Islands, Galvez went around South Louisiana and scouted locations where to settle them. This map shows you where those settlements were located, and I show the rivers in blue to indicate the reasoning why these areas were chosen. St. Bernard and Barataria were chosen because of their proximity to New Orleans and the ability to defend New Orleans from the east and from the south. Barataria, however, was basically uninhabitable. It flooded constantly. It was marsh. There were initially people settled there, but they abandoned it pretty quickly and went to the other settlements. The settlement of St. Bernard was successful, and it was also isolated. No one traveled through St. Bernard to get anywhere else. So they were able to retain the culture and the language for quite some time. The two main settlements that we talk about in the group that I'm the president of are Galvestown and Valenzuela, because they were the settlements in the Baton Rouge area and where the descendants of those people mainly live today. So going back to the timeline, in January of 1779, the first settlers arrive at the Galvestown settlement. Now, if you go along Highway 42 today in Ascension Parish, you'll see this historical marker. This is the location where Galvestown was located. It was along the Amite River, right at the spot where Bayou Manchac branches off from it. You can see, according to the sign, the story of the settlers who came there. And the town was abandoned by 1810. The town suffered a lot of tragedy. A third of the settlers died in the first year there from disease. And there were storms that ravaged it and flooding that took place often. One thing I also want to point out on the sign is it says here, Canary Islanders and Isleños in parentheses. Isleños is the Spanish word for islanders. And the Canary Islanders in Louisiana were referred to in that way. They were referred to as the Isleños. Galvestown was actually the only settlement laid out like a town, as you can see from this early map. It's interesting because maps at this time, for whatever reason, north is straight down and south is straight up. So basically the map is upside down. But you see at the bottom, there's the Amite River, and then there's the map of Galvestown. Oddly enough, there's no evidence of this today. We know it was built, but at the place it was built, we can find no evidence of it or any evidence of a cemetery there. There was an archaeological dig conducted there in 2014 by a professor from LSU, but nothing was really found. So back to the timeline, you see here in February of 79, the last ship of that first wave leaves the islands. And in March, the first settlers arrive at the settlement of Valenzuela. So here you can see the historical marker at Valenzuela. This is along Highway 308 along Bayou Lafourche, just south of Donisonville. And you can see there that later on, it was the site of a plantation. Now, this is an early map of Valenzuela. Again, it's kind of upside down. North is facing straight down. That's the Mississippi River at the bottom. And then you can see Bayou Lafourche coming off of the Mississippi and these strips of land that were the original settlers there. And some of the names on this map are Falcon, Alamont, Hidalgo, Pereira. Names that are still present in these areas. Later that same year, in June of 1779, Spain formally declares war on Britain. So at this point, the ships coming from the islands have to stop because they're at war now. Some of the ships stop in Cuba, other ships never make it into the Gulf. And they have to go to alternate places until later they can come on to Louisiana. This also means that now Galvez can take action against the British now that they're formally at war. So as I said before, this was a military recruitment. So this is actually the flag of the Louisiana infantry in 1779 that served under Galvez. And you can see here is a depiction of what the soldiers would have looked like at that time. And there's the flag they have with them. So as I said, in June, Spain declared war on Britain. A few months later was the Battle of Baton Rouge. In the Battle of Baton Rouge, which Baton Rouge at that time was under British control, and it was actually called New Richmond. There was a fort there that was heavily defended by troops, but nevertheless, Galvez bombarded it and attacked it and was able to defeat the British and take the territory back for Spain. As a thanks for their participation in the Battle of Baton Rouge, later on in 1805, the governor of Spanish West Florida, Carlos de Grand Prix, granted land in Baton Rouge to be given to the Canary Islanders who had come from Galvestown to fight so that they might continue to live on Spanish soil. And as you can see, that land was Spanish Town, which is a neighborhood in Baton Rouge today, the oldest neighborhood in Baton Rouge. So back to the timeline, after Galvez captured Baton Rouge, he went on to capture Mobile and then Pensacola. What's important to mention here is that when the Americans began the rebellion, the British had control of the entire East Coast as well as the Gulf Coast. So they basically sealed off all the ports. There was no way for the Americans to get supplies. The only way they could was basically to come through Spanish territory up the Mississippi River and go kind of the back way. And that is what was used to get them all the supplies they needed, including ammunition and money and resources. And without that, they would definitely have not been successful. And in 1781, once Galvez captures Pensacola, that basically puts an end to British rule on the Gulf Coast. And that's a devastating blow to the British Navy. And one of the things that brings about, that contributes to bringing about the end of the war. So Galvez serves as governor until 1783. Then he moves to Mexico City, where he passes away in 1786. Now Galvez, back in 2014, Galvez was only the eighth person in history to be named an honorary citizen of the United States of America for his contributions to the American Revolution. And he's buried in Mexico City. Now some of the people who came over, as shown here on this chart, you see some of these names stayed the same. They're still spelled the way they were originally spelled today. And some, the ones in parentheses, changed. Basically, Louisiana was only Spanish for 38 years. Then the French took back over. So basically you'd have a Spanish family that would bring a baby to be baptized by a French priest, and they would give the priest the name, and the priest would write down kind of phonetically what he thought it should spell like. And so there were lots of different spellings of lots of these names, and kind of the names, like for example, Caballero became Cavier, which is more of a French pronunciation of the same word. So as a result of this, a lot of the descendants of these people were not aware that they were Spanish at all. They always assumed that they were French because they had names like Rivere or Plaisance. But the origin of some of these names, as you can see, were Spanish. One of the things our society does is to help people trace their ancestry back to the people who came over on the ships. A lot of people think they don't have this heritage because, you know, they're a Landry or a Leblanc or an Hébert. But if you think about it, the time frame when these people came over to Louisiana was roughly 238 years ago. That's roughly eight generations. And if you go eight generations back on your family tree, you've got 256 great times six grandparents. So the odds that one of them may fall into this group is pretty good. Just as a crazy random example, a team that I worked on here at Blue Cross in the past, the server team, there were four of us on a team of 10 that I found had Isleño ancestry. Here's the contact information for our group. If you want to check us out on Facebook, that's our Instagram in the middle and our website at the bottom. And you can see more about what our group does and our mission. So I guess at this time, sorry, hold on one second. I guess if there's any questions at this time, we would take those. So we're going to do a little trivia about the things I've talked about. And we're going to use something called Kahoot. So the slide you're seeing now tells you about the way it works. So on your phone or mobile device, you need to go to kahoot.it in a browser. You can also use your camera and scan this QR code, which will take you to the site. Now, the screen I'm going to share is going to have a game pin on it that you're going to put in to play the game. You're going to put in the pin and then put in your username. You're going to see the questions on the screen as I display them, but you don't answer them on your computer. You need to answer them on your mobile device. As you can see in the picture here, you'll see the question up on the screen with the four choices, four colored blocks, and you press the corresponding one on your mobile device to answer. Each question is going to have 30 seconds to answer it, and the points, it's worth 1,000 points each if you can answer it immediately, and then the points start to go down as time goes on. If you do answer it correctly, even with just a 1 second left, you still get 500 points. So it goes from 1,000 to 500. Of course, if you get the question wrong, you get 0 points. One moment. Okay, you should all see the Kahoot screen now. And you should see the pin code there at the top. Also, the QR code is displayed again in case you need it. So once again, scan that and go to the site on your phone. Or you can go to kahoot.it if the QR code is not working for you. And I'll go ahead and give a couple minutes for some folks to get connected to it. Yeah, so I see in the chat, there's a question about Galvestown. So Galvestown, as I said, in the first year that people were there, a third of the people died of a smallpox outbreak. There was also flooding. There were at least two hurricanes that came through and destroyed everything. They continued to have a few people there until I believe the early 1800s, and then it was eventually abandoned. So I see we've got 12 to 13 people join the game, which is great. I'm going to have a couple of questions at first that'll be like warm-up questions. Then we'll get to the real meat of it. All right, well, I guess we can go ahead and get started with the trivia. So remember, again, just a reminder, you want to answer on your mobile device. So just have your mobile device handy, watch the screen for the question, and then press the corresponding answer on your mobile device. And remember, the faster you get it right, the more points you will receive. All righty. Here we go. Spanish influence on American independence. Here is question one. How do you say hello in Spanish? Is it hola, salud, bonjour, or aloha? Now the timer will tick down from 30 seconds. It will allow everybody 30 seconds to answer, but if everyone answers it before the 30 seconds runs out, then the question will stop. So as long as the timer is still going, we still got folks who haven't answered yet. All right, time is up, and it looks like everybody got that one right. It is hola. Hello in Spanish. Also, in between each question, it'll show you the current statistics, the leaderboard, who's on top. So there we go. We can see the top five. First Gen is in first place. Good choice of a name there. All right, we'll go on to question two. What color is on the flag of the USA, but not on the flag of Spain? Is it red, blue, yellow, or green? So what color is on the flag of the United States of America, but is not on the flag of Spain? All right, time is up. The answer was blue. The Spanish flag is basically red, white, and yellow, or gold. And of course, the American flag is red, white, and blue. So let's check the leaderboard. Looks like Missy has taken first place. Kara is the highest climber, so Kara's coming up. We'll go to question three. How many men were in the initial recruitment order to serve in the Spanish Louisiana militia? Is it 2,300, 700, 500, or 1,492? So in the initial recruitment order for men for the militia in the Canary Islands, what was the number they were initially looking for of men? There's that depiction again of the soldiers. All right, looks like we got some different answers this time around. The answer was 700. It was originally a recruitment order for 700 men, which turned into 2,300 when they allowed families to come over. Looks like Missy is still in the lead, but Manshack is on fire. Three correct answers in a row. So that's good. We'll roll on to question number four. Before Bernardo de Galvez, how many other people in history had been named honorary citizens of the USA? Is it 0, 10, 7, or 5? So before Galvez was named an honorary citizen, how many people had already gotten that honor? That's one of the most commonly used depictions of Galvez, that picture. All right, looks like most people got it right. It was 7. Galvez was the 8th person to be named an honorary citizen in 2014, also the most recent person to be named an honorary citizen. So let's check out the leaderboard. Looks like GB has taken the lead with 37-22. But it looks like Mantrix is up 5 places. So he's coming up, or he or she is coming up. All righty, let's get to question number 5. Who was the Spanish governor who provided George Washington with the name United States of America? Was it Bernardo de Galvez, Alejandro O'Reilly, Antonio de Ulloa, or Luis de Gonzaga? So he drafted a letter to Washington and included that phrase, which obviously stuck. And the answer was Luis de Gonzaga, the 4th Spanish governor of Louisiana. Looks like we had answers spread all across the board on that one. We'll update the scoreboard now. Looks like Manshack has taken first place. So we'll go on to question number six. From what island did Columbus bring sugarcane to the New World? So from one of the islands in the Canary Islands, Columbus picked up clippings of sugarcane and brought them to Hispaniola, which obviously had a huge impact on Louisiana, as sugar is a major industry in Louisiana. All right, looks like two folks got that one right. It was La Gomera. La Gomera is the island that he stopped at on his second voyage and got those sugarcane plants. Go back to the scoreboard here. Looks like we pretty much stayed the same at the top. First, Jen's coming back up though. So we will move on now to question number seven. Canary Islands make up how many provinces of Spain? So as I mentioned, it's a group of seven islands. I think it's eight islands today. They've recognized another island as an official island of the territory. But those islands constitute how many provinces of the Kingdom of Spain? Is it two, seven, one, or eight? Correct answer is two, makes up two provinces. I'll update the scoreboard. Looks like Missy and GB swap places. Manshack still in the lead. And we'll go on to question number eight. The Canary Islands have been under the Spanish crown since what year? Is it 1492, 1510, 1479, or 1677? I mentioned this toward the beginning of the presentation, so. Well, looks like everybody answered. The correct answer was 1479. Looks like most people got it right. Going back to the scoreboard, first Jen, three correct answers in a row coming up. Still pretty close though. We'll go on to question nine. Which Spanish Louisiana governor executed those responsible for leading the Louisiana Rebellion of 1768? Is it Antonio de Ulloa, Bernardo de Galvez, Luis de Gonzaga, or Alejandro O'Reilly? Remember, the governor who first came to Louisiana was rejected by the French colonists. They rioted against him. They forced him out of town. And then another Spanish governor came in and tried, convicted, and executed those responsible. But the correct answer is O'Reilly. The governor who they forced out was Antonio de Ulloa, but the governor who came and replaced him and who crushed the rebellion was Alejandro O'Reilly. Going back to the scoreboard, it's like everybody stayed in the same spot. So we've got three questions left. So let's see what happens. Question number 10. What was Baton Rouge named while under British control? Was it New Richmond, New Sussex, New London, or New Birmingham? So the fort that was there when it was under British control was the same name. And it was only named this for a very brief period of time. So the answer was New Richmond. New Richmond, probably most people got that one. Looking at the scoreboard, Manshack's still on top. It looks like some people swapped places. First Jen's in second place, Missy's in third place. And we will go on to question number 11. Where was Bernardo de Galvez born? Was it Madrid, Malaga, Barcelona, or Lisbon? You might remember I also mentioned that he brought some people from his hometown to Louisiana as colonists settle what became New Iberia. So some of those family names you can still find today are like Romero, Gary, Viator, Segura. All right, so it looks like six people got that one right. He was born in Malaga. Okay, scoreboard update. Looks like everybody's in the same spot. We got one question left. So here we go. Question number 12. Which of the following places did Galvez not win a single victory against the British? So was it Baton Rouge, Mobile, Galveston, or Pensacola? So I mentioned three of these four places where he won victories against the British. So it's the one that he did not win a victory at is the answer. Which of these four did he not win a victory? And the answer is Galveston. So Galveston is named for Galvez, but it was not one of the areas that battle took place against the British. Those battles were at Baton Rouge, Mobile, and Pensacola. So we now look at the final scores. See, Missy came in third place. First, Jen came in second. And number one, the winner, is Manchak. So congratulations, good job. You got all but one right. And I believe we have prizes for the winners, and Selmo probably has more information on that.
Chad, thank you very much for this presentation. I bet you everybody enjoyed getting all the report from Facebook and Zoom, that they really enjoyed the information shared here. I personally loved it. Having some Canary ancestry myself made me proud of what our lineage have contributed to make the US what it is today. Yes, for the winners, please send an email with your information to Anselmo, that's A-N-S-E-L-M-O, dot Rodriguez, that's R-O-D-R-I-G-U-E-Z, at bcbsla.com. I'm gonna put it in the if you can, one of the producers can put it on the chat, I appreciate that. What I need you to do is send me your name and your contact information, maybe a phone number or an email, so I can reach out to you and talk about a little gift that we will be giving away as a result of the trivia. Again, congratulations to the winners, Manchak, First Jane, and Missy. Thank you. I like to, we're kind of running over the time right now, but I want to thank the Los Isleños Heritage and Cultural Society of Louisiana for allowing Chad and himself to be part of this presentation. I want to make sure people take note of where they are, their contact information, because they are there and it would be great to go and visit their museum in the San Bernard Parish area. Thank you for your kind attention. We invite you to be alert for future events. We hope that today's program help us understand a little bit better how Hispanics are not just recent immigrants, first, second, or third generation American, but also are long-term members of our American dream of life, freedom, and the pursuit of happiness. God bless you all and happy 4th of July. Feliz Día de la Independencia. Thank you.